But it is not all gloom for refugees in the world. For some, the sky is the limit. Saud Lulat came to Kenya as a refugee when he was only 6 months old. He lived at the Dadaab refugee camp for 20 years before relocating to the U.S. Today, 29-year-old Olat is a front runner in the Minneapolis Ward 6 City Council elections due in August. And Saud Lulat joins me live from Minneapolis, Minnesota, in the USA for conversation on the good, the bad, and the ugly in his life. Saud, how are you?
I'm doing good, Linda. Thank you for having me. You and the team at TV 47.
Thank you for choosing to, of course, talk to us tonight.
I really appreciate it. With this, you know, this World Refugee Day is an important day for many refugees, as millions of people who are displaced around the world. It's a big day for us. I'm really grateful that I joined you today.
All right, thank you. So today you are also contesting against eight other strong contenders for a political office in Minneapolis. Briefly, paint a picture of your journey since you left Somalia at that tender age of only 6 months.
Yeah, 6 months old, you know, I was born in Somalia, and the civil war erupted in our country, and we flee and seek a refugee in Kenya, and we came to Kenya as a refugees in 1991 with my family and millions of other Somali refugees. The United Nations and government of Kenya give us the hospitality and the welcoming that we enjoyed for the next 20 years. I called home Kenya until I left to the United States 8 years ago. And today, with all those horrible stories that we're hearing with the pandemic going on, there's still refugee stories to tell.
All right. Now, where is your family now that you mentioned it? Your siblings, your parents?
My mom and my dad and rest of my family are now in Minnesota, and they joined me after we've been separated for almost 7 years, and they joined me in 2017, and I'm so happy that I reunited with my family in the work of the travel ban, with the refugee shutdown, all those all those disappointments, and there's no refugees coming to this country or other countries to start new lives. I was happy to my family joined me, but still we have a lot of work to do when it comes to advocating and speaking for those refugees. But my family are now in Minnesota, and they reunited me with me 4 years ago.
We've just, of course, broadcasted a story on a woman who's now somewhere crying upon the UNHCR to ensure that at least she's able to be taken care of, and most importantly, she notes that her child was taken and she's not able to know where she is. I mean, what did it take you to reunite with your family?
Yeah, it took me up to 8-9 years. It took years to reunite with your family. I moved to the United States in 2012, and my family joined me in 2017. And after that, it was, you know, refugee shutdown or the travel ban by the President of the United States. So it took me years, my family, to join me. And that was just a story of too many refugees who were unable to reunite with their loved ones. And even as we speak right now, my wife lives in Nairobi and she can't join me even if I win this race because of the travel ban and what's going on in this country. Right. So with this refugee day, there's a lot of challenges still facing refugees, whether in Kenya or here in the United States.
Right. So if you were to compare opportunities for refugees in Kenya and Minnesota, what would you say?
Refugees in Kenya and refugees in the United States are two different things. And despite what is happening in our southern borders, the way, you know, we're treating refugees, is still people like myself who got a resettlement. Our case is different because when you come to this country as a refugee, you will be getting welcoming, and you will be getting all the documents that you need. You are legally here, and you will be able to find a job. You will be able to find you know, higher standard education, and you will be able to get opportunities just like any other American. I become a naturalized citizen just 3 years ago, so you can tell I'm enjoying all the freedom any other American enjoys. So that's the difference, and I hope African leaders, you know, basically, especially Kenya, they will give those fellow African, you know, refugees who come to these countries the free movement that they need, so that they can bring all those opportunities. If a refugee is given opportunity, they will have, sky is the limit, as you said, and they will be able to bring more opportunities and developments to those countries that hosted them. So, but it's a different case in Kenya. You are not allowed to move. You are not allowed to do things. You've been stranded in those refugee camps. Yeah. So, and that's been, everything I remember about refugees of today, the World Refugee Day. It reminds me when I was in Kenya, because I could not move. I could not do anything. But still, I am grateful the welcoming and the peace loving Kenyan people who hosted us. But the governments do not do the right thing for the refugees except hosting them. There's no movement of refugees, and that's the most challenge refugees facing. They need opportunity, they need access to better education. So all those challenges need to be resolved, and that only can be done to our public elected officials and our leaders.
All right, we hope that cry will land into the right ears. Now, you talked about the sky being the limit, and we have labeled you, you know, the man who dared to dream. What key things do you seek to address for the people of Minneapolis as it stands right now? And what is your strategy, your main strategy for the August 11 polls?
In Minneapolis is one of the progressive cities in the United States. So you can tell 8 years ago, I moved to this country with my just a teenager and with no family. And I started a new life in this country. Now, within 8 years, as after I graduated from university and, you know, continue my advocacy, I have seen the real challenges facing my community. We have a significant number of East African community in this Ward 6 particularly. So that inspired me to seek this office and continue speaking and advocating for our community when it comes to public housing, health, economic equality, education, and bring a gap to the disparity that's impacting our communities in this Minneapolis city and the entire state of Minnesota.
Mm-hmm. All right, that's incredible. Now, Jamal Osman is your senior and one of your opponents in the race. Now, the two of you have so much in common. What sets you apart and what makes you more qualified than him?
When I come to this country, I was a member of various different organizations, some of them that operate in Kenya, here in the United States and in Kenya. And I was out there speaking African leaders, whether it's Kenyan leaders or Somali leaders or members of the United States Congress. I was out there advocating in the halls of the United States Congress, you know, playing a role, landmark legislation that will help Africa to prosper, such as Electrify Africa, economic and anti-corruption fight, you know, in those that's crippling the economy of Africa. So without 8 years only I'm here, I was working, I was a long-term volunteer with an organization called The One Campaign. I was a board member of Fulamate. I was not just sitting there, I was advocating for my community. And that makes me exceptional for when it comes to city council. This city of Minneapolis, a city of a $1 billion-plus budget, and we need someone who understands these things. With my skills and experience and advocacy and first-hand information, gives me an opportunity to represent my people and ask them to vote for me in the August 11 polls, because I was in my track record someone who advocate and someone who was advocating for the community when it comes to public housing, senior community, education for our children, and business opportunities for our especially women and young girls. So all that combined gives me an exceptional leadership when it comes to advocating for my community, especially the East African community in this city of Minneapolis.
Now, let's face it, you are African, and we have seen what has been happening with the Black Lives Matter demos. What do you make of the indifference that we have between the people and the police?
In the city of Minneapolis has been on the spot, the global spotlight for the past few months because of what happened when George Floyd was killed by the police in Minneapolis after a police officer in Minneapolis put his knee on the neck of George Floyd, and that you know, lots of protests worldwide, and we know this has been happening for quite long time. As a council member, if I'm elected, I will continue holding police accountable, calling our leaders to improve the lives of African Americans or other African people like myself who immigrated to this country. There is a lot of work we need to do when it comes to bringing equality, economic development, racial, social justice for African people, especially the African Americans, and building trust between the police and the government. So there's a lot of challenges facing our community when it comes to relationship we have with the police. So with that, you know, high profile incident that we lost our brother George Floyd, who died in that tragic incident, and now we're calling for more and more transparency and accountability, and leaders who are in power right now, whether it's the United States Congress or the United States Senate or the President of the United States or the city level or county level, leaders need to do something now. Enough is enough, and these people can't wait.
All right. You may have touched on this, but I'll ask all the same. What is your message on this World Refugee Day?
In this World Refugee Day, there is approximately up to 80 million refugees who are flee from their home countries, and other millions who are internally displaced within their countries, particularly and mostly in Africa. So we are calling world leaders and the United Nations and African leaders, the African Union, to do something about the plight of the refugees. What is happening? We have the biggest, we're facing two pandemics right now with the refugee crisis, with this racism and all those race issues going on in this country. With the refugees, they are most vulnerable people now. They are, with this pandemic, they've been hit hard by the pandemic. So we're asking the world leaders to bring durable solutions for the refugee crisis, because they're just human beings. They've been dehumanized, you know, they've been harassed. A lot of young people now have identity crisis. Like, just my story is just like any other story of millions of refugees worldwide. We need world leaders to do something. It's not enough to celebrate the World Refugee Day every year without doing something tangible for the refugees, whether it's a resettlement, whether it's a repatriation, refugees going back to their home countries. And the most important, world leaders need to do something about the peace in Africa so that we can bring durable solutions for the refugee crisis. You know, whether it's education, whether it's a movement, whether it's a security, the refugees are the most vulnerable in our communities. And that's why people like myself, who were former refugees and now are running for public house in the United States, I will do everything I can and urge world leaders to do something and bring something tangible so that we can improve the lives of those people. Mm-hmm.
All right. Thank you so much, Sud Olad, of course, candidate on the public office, Ward 6, Minneapolis. Thank you so much for being a force to reckon, for a good example of being a good example, and most importantly, a story of hope to the numerous refugees across the world. We can only wish you nothing but the best, and as you, of course, await to see, to eat, that you're able to garner that on the poll of August 11. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Linda, and I wish you all the best, and I want to, like, Kenya and all those countries to do something so that we can improve and make refugees history.
All right, thank you so much, and it's now time that again we take a short break. We'll be right back with much more. Remember, it's also important that you interact with us, #SaturdayNightLive. We'll be sampling some of your questions as we proceed with the show.